Epistemologists that are interested in testimony often make the assumption, at least implicitly, that understanding the epistemic significance of communicative exchanges is mainly about understanding the epistemic significance of the speech act of assertion. The aim of this talk is to put into question this assumption about the centrality of assertion and about trying to convince you that a lot could be gained if epistemologists expanded the domain of interest of their discipline to include also knowledge that is based on speech acts other than assertion. So when we think about epistemology as a discipline, we think about a discipline that is concerned with many different doxastic sources and how they can grant knowledge. So we may wonder how we can acquire knowledge from perception, from memory, from introspection or the awareness of our internal states, from deduction, so inferentially and so forth. And testimony, if you want, arrived a bit late to the party. So until the 1980s, analytic philosophers didn't really write much about testimony. And often epistemologists that are concerned with testimony present it as the missing piece of a puzzle, the missing piece of this puzzle that our epistemic lives are. So the idea here is that unless we investigate testimony, we will have a complete picture of the different ways in which we form beliefs and acquire knowledge. When we say that we should investigate testimony, what are we really proposing to analyze and study? If you look at the specialist literature, there seems to be a consensus that the domain of inquiry of this discipline, of the epistemology of testimony, are those beliefs and justification of knowledge that are grounded on assertions. So the assumption here is that the source of testimonial beliefs and testimonial knowledge are acts of assertion or acts of telling someone something. So for future reference, I'll call the assumption that testimonial beliefs are grounded on assertion the assertion paradigm. And the assertion paradigm is more pervasive than you might think. So this is a view that is stated quite explicitly in many foundational texts. Here you have Fricke's Against Gullibility, and she writes, "The domain of potential knowledge through testimony is that of serious assertions aimed at communication." Similarly, Adler writes in the Stanford Encyclopedia entry about testimony that testimony is the assertion of a declarative sentence by a speaker to a hearer or an audience. Of course, the assertion paradigm comes in different flavors and terminology may vary. So for instance, Cody and Graham link testimony to the act of making a statement. Here we have the word statement instead of assertion. And assurance theory, like Moran, Hinchman, Faulkner, McMiller, prefer to focus on a subset of assertion that they call tellings. So you tell your audience something only when you invite them to take your word for it, so that a telling is a sort of subset of assertion, a kind of assertion. But we can put aside all these differences, because my point here is that epistemologists agree that something like assertoric force is required or necessary for a belief to have a testimonial base. I just want to be clear here that I'm not claiming that the assertion paradigm is about sharing a common definition of what assertion is between epistemologists. The idea here is rather that there is a sort of shared assumption about what the domain of investigation is. And namely, the idea here is that we are interested in analyzing beliefs, justification, and knowledge that is based on assertoric acts. So my point is that making the assumption that we're interested in this kind of knowledge basis and belief basis affects the kind of questions that we ask and the kind of answers that we give. So to give you an example, it would mean that in order to settle whether and when it is rational to trust testimony, we will have to ask under which condition, if at all, it is rational to trust what other people tell us. So here the emphasis is on the speech of telling. Similarly, for the reductionist
versus anti-reductionist debate. We might understand it as a debate about whether or not we have a pro-tanto warrant to believe what other people assert. And people who are concerned with the conditions under which we are entitled to testify a proposition that something is the case understand this question as a question about under which conditions we are entitled to make an assertion. So my point here is that there are some assumptions about what the domain of the discipline is that affect which kind of questions we ask and how we settle them. So this is what I mean by saying that there is something like an assertion paradigm. So my suggestion in this talk is that we would have a lot to gain from abandoning the assertion paradigm and moving beyond it. My reasoning here surely owes a lot to Austin's work, and in particular his famous William James lecture. A central theme of these lectures, as you probably know, is something that Austin calls the descriptive fallacy. So that would be the assumption common between philosophers of his time that understanding communication is mostly about understanding assertoric uses of language, or what Austin calls constitutive, meaning those utterances that describe reality as being in a certain way. Austin pointed out that an excessive focus on constitutive was leading philosophy to focus too much on truth conditions when analyzing language, and too little on other conditions that make a contribution to the conversation appropriate, or in his favorite terms, felicitous. So I'm here especially interested in two lessons that one can draw from Austin's work. The first is that you can't understand how communication works unless you move beyond the study of constitutive. This means that if you study language, you have to focus also on non-assertoric uses of language, what Austin called performative utterances, speech acts that can change the word rather than describing it. So standard examples here would be the act of issuing a command, of marrying a couple, or adjourning a session. A second lesson I'm interested in, and that connects to my proposal, is that we should reject a strong dichotomy between constitutive and performative uses. There's no sharp line that can be drawn between them according to Austin. And one reason for this is that there is an important sense in which assertions change the world on top of describing. So for instance, they impose certain commitments on the speaker, and there is also a constitutive component in performatives. To give you again an example, in making a promise, I don't only undertake a responsibility to do what I promise, but I also describe a certain future state of affairs and claim that it will be the case that what I describe as true in the future will be true. So if all this is right, then there seems to be a sense in which the assertion paradigm is too narrow. If we take Austin's lessons seriously, it's inevitable, I think, to suspect that the assertion paradigm in epistemology leads us to exclude from the domain of investigation an important part of the missing piece of the puzzle that we were considering earlier, namely those beliefs that are based on non-assertoric communicative acts. So if we can acquire knowledge from non-assertoric speech acts, the assertion paradigm is too narrow, is not apt to capture an important fraction of what we can learn from words. Of course, this idea becomes even more appealing if we take seriously Austin's second suggestion, namely that there is no strong dichotomy between assertoric and non-assertoric uses. And this is because if assertions can grant knowledge, and if there is a continuum between assertoric and non-assertoric uses, then there may be an interesting sense in which we can gain knowledge also from non-assertoric communication. The suggestion here is that the study of beliefs, justification, and knowledge that are grounded on non-assertoric speech acts may be regarded as a sort of natural continuation of the research agenda of the epistemology of testimony, rather than a different discipline, a different kind of study altogether. So now I want to consider some cases in which it should be apparent that we can gain knowledge from speech outside of an assertion in a way that has important similarities with standard cases of testimony. So I'll start with promises. Here's an example. Suppose that a friend tells me that he's going to Bologna this summer to inform me about his future plans. This would be an assertion. And it would be very different if my friend promised instead that she will visit me in Bologna. This would be a promise by means of which she commits to this future course of action, namely going to Bologna. Clearly, these two utterances have very similar communicative function. Both can be used to communicate that the speaker will be in Bologna during the summer, and if trusted, they would seem to induce basically the same belief, again, that the belief that the speaker would be in Bologna in the summer. And in both cases, if I trust the speaker, it would seem that I have a novel reason to believe that they will be in Bologna, namely, the reason is that they told me so. I want to stress here, just to be clear, that I'm not trying to say that there are no differences between these few utterances. Of course, they've got different force and slightly different content. I also don't want to say that these differences are irrelevant. And in fact, it would seem that the promise gives me better reason to believe that my friend is going to visit Bologna. So if something, it would seem that in the case of the non-assertoric speech act, I get a stronger warrant for belief than in the case of the assertoric speech act. Now consider command orders. Let's imagine a military scenario, okay? My comrade reads our daily chores, what we have to do during the day, from a list of tasks that was written by the lieutenant. And she tells me, Neri, our job today is to pick up all the rubbish. So this is an assertion because she's just reporting an order. But now suppose that the lieutenant says, in a different context, Neri, pick up all the rubbish immediately. This would be an order. In both cases, it would seem that we learn from an act of communication pretty much the same thing, namely, what I have to do in this particular situation. There are, of course, differences between the two utterances, in this case, even syntactical differences, and there are differences in how we acquire knowledge in the two cases. For the moment, let's consider some other families of elocutionary acts. One is declarative. We may consider the case between a judge saying the defendant was found guilty at the end of the trial, which has the value of a declaration, and a journalist writing the very same statement in a newspaper as a report of what happened in the trial. Here the content is exactly the same, but force and epistemic import differ in some important way, or at least again, I'll come back to the epistemic differences between the cases. For expressive, we may consider the difference between asserting that a cake is delicious and expressing our gastronomic approval with a loud yum or wow. So the main takeaway here is that there are many ways in which we can acquire knowledge through communication, not just being told something, but also being at the receiving end of other speech acts. So if our goal is to make sense of the different ways in which we can acquire knowledge, it would seem that there is still a sort of untapped missing piece of the puzzle, and that we should pay attention to those beliefs that are based on non-assertoric speech acts on top of those beliefs that are based on assertoric ones. So we've also seen that despite all the differences that we have identified, there are some important points of continuity between the kind of knowledge that we acquire from non-assertoric speech acts and the kind of knowledge that we acquire from assertoric speech acts. So it would seem natural, as we suggested earlier, to regard this project as a continuation or expansion of the research agenda of epistemology of testimony rather than a parallel or contrasting project altogether. So a quick note, once again, I'm not here proposing to redefine what testimony is, to propose a new definition, a new label. I'm totally fine with finding a new name for this expanded research agenda. We may prefer to talk of epistemology of communication and still regard the epistemology of testimony as a totally coherent subset of this domain of inquiry. My point here is just that we have something to gain from expanding the horizons of a research agenda onto non-assertoric speeches. So you may ask at this point, how would the alternative research agenda look like? Well, shifting the paradigm would first of all mean that we have a shift in domain. So rather than investigating testimonial beliefs that are grounded on assertoric acts, we would investigate beliefs that are grounded on speech acts more generally, only some of which are assertions. Similarly, we would have to rethink the question that we ask and the way in which we settle them. So instead of settling questions about the epistemology of assertion, we would be settling questions about the epistemology of speech acts more generally. And at this point, it can be useful to consider some example to illustrate what the shifting paradigm could mean. So let's focus on the problem of what warrants testimonial knowledge. The assertion paradigm has so far led philosophers to try to find solutions and consider candidates that are appropriate for knowledge that is based on assertion. So, on one famous view, we are entitled to believe a piece of testimony only if we have reasons to believe, or we lack reason to disbelieve, that the speaker is sincere and that their assertion is accurate. And in turn, sincerity is here understood as something that has to do with belief, and accuracy is a matter of getting things right, basically. Authors like Goldberg and more recently Simeon have suggested that if we are rationally entitled to believe testimony, it is because there is an epistemic norm that governs assertions, making them reliable. For assurance theories, rationally believing testimony is a matter of accepting an invitation to trust the speaker that comes together with making an assertion. So moving beyond the assertion paradigm would lead us to reconsider whether these answers are fully satisfying. So, to illustrate, promises complicate the first view, perhaps minimally, but they complicate it. Sincerity in promises is not just a matter of beliefs, but also a matter of intentions. We have to expand what sincerity means. Accuracy in promises, again, is something that is under the speaker control, so it boils down to whether they are true to their words, so to say, whether they live up to their promise, rather than boiling down to some external factor, like whether the description fits the way the word actually is. In orders and declaration, the differences are even more apparent. We can see that whether we are warranted to form a belief based on what the speaker says will depend here on whether the speaker has the authority to perform the speech.
Of course, a parallel point applies to the view that testimonial warrant is linked to the norm of assertion that governs the speech act of assertion. Of course, if you want to explain how testimonial warrant works in non-assertoric speech act, you will need to expand this hypothesis onto more general illocutionary norms, not just the norm of assertion, but more generally the illocutionary norms that govern different illocutionary acts. A similar point for trusting, of course, a different kind of trust is involved in, say, forming a belief on the basis of an order. You're going to trust the different felicity conditions obtained, namely, for instance, that the speaker has the relevant authority to issue a certain order. So every hypothesis we've considered so far needs to be revised in light of our more general explanatory goal, namely explaining how we can acquire knowledge from communication more generally.
So we have seen how old questions will require new answers, but moving to a new paradigm also means that we will ask altogether new questions. A crucial one is the following. Can we formulate general conditions for believing on the basis of what an agent has communicated, or do we need a different account for different kinds of illocution? So is there a general rule that we can now extrapolate from the different cases, or perhaps we have to elaborate a different account of what warrants testimonial belief for different speech acts or different families of speech acts. Another question we may ask is whether or not there are some speech acts that offer a better epistemic warrant than others, so a more reliable warrant. And if the answer is positive, we might want to explain why. Why is it the case, for instance, that it would seem that a promise gives you a better epistemic warrant than an assertion, or that the declaration gives you a better epistemic warrant than an assertion? This is an interesting question that opens up only when we abandon the assertion paradigm. Similarly, we might think, is it maybe the case that reductionism is more appealing when applied to some subdomains, for instance, expressive or assertives, than others, for instance, declaratives or commissives? If it is true that we have a stronger warrant coming from some of these speech acts, perhaps we might think that those sort of stronger speech acts are less likely to succumb to the reductionist argument. I can imagine a number of different objections that one might have against the project I've just sketched. One is that all the examples that I considered so far fit the assertion paradigm, either because they are genuine assertions or because there is some epicycle, so to say, that can be added to the assertion paradigm and that we'll be able to deal with them. I have a limited time here, so I want to focus on the second worry because I find it slightly more pressing. The idea here is that you could insist that you weren't convinced at all by any of the examples I've presented. Maybe you think that for each pair that I consider so far, so the assertion and the promise, the assertion and the order and so on, there is an important difference between the beliefs or knowledge that is grounded on the assertory communication and the beliefs or knowledge that are grounded on the non-assertory counterpart. And you may think that these can give us a reason to stick to the assertion paradigm rather than reject it. So let's see how we could make this objection more precise. But keep in mind that here I'm considering one way of phrasing it, but we could change this objection based on your favorite view of testimony. So suppose that you accept the following view of testimony. You think that testimony is all about transmitting epistemic justification and knowledge rather than generating it. So the mechanism of testimony on this view is that there is someone that acquires knowledge and then passes on the knowledge to someone else. So testimony is often said to work like this, and in the sense to be like memory. The difference here would be that in memory, the receiver coincides with the transmitter, so that you transmit to yourself knowledge that you had in the past. And in testimony, instead, you have an interpersonal version of transmission. You may want to suggest at this point that non-assertory testimony behaves differently because it generates entirely new reasons to believe the proposition. So if we go back to the example of the defendant is guilty proffered by the judge, we have a case in which the judge is not really passing on some knowledge that they had before. Rather, there is an important sense in which they are generating an altogether new reason to believe the proposition. Let's bracket for a moment all known objections to transmission views about testimony, because I'm just interested in considering the merit of a response along these lines. First of all, we might think that not every assertoric speech act involves generation, so that this objection doesn't apply to all the cases I'm interested in. So consider swearing. Swearing fits the picture of transmission. I swear that I saw something and I transmit some knowledge that I already had rather than generating it. Promising and other commissives seem perhaps to fall in between. There is a sense in which they transmit knowledge, but they also seem to generate some new obligations that support that very knowledge. Expressives are less controversial. I think they just transmit. In addition to this, I think I could argue that it's not obvious at all that transmission is involved in the remaining families of elocution, like, for instance, directives. So if you take, for instance, a standard Gricean understanding of speech acts, basically every speech act is about expressing a psychological state. So for instance, orders and requests are analyzed as acts whereby a speaker expresses an intention that the hearer do something. So in this Gracia reading, some kind of transmission is involved in every speech act. And even if we think that some speech acts still make an exception, say official declarations maybe don't fit the picture even on a Gracian understanding, then we still see that a great deal of the proposal I've presented so far would survive the objection. Even if we had a few casualties, we would still have very strong reasons to abandon the assertion paradigm. And we would only have that the paradigm should be expanded a bit less than we initially envisaged. So to conclude, I've defended three claims that are in tension in one way or another with the assertion paradigm. The first one is about there being a new piece of the puzzle, so to say. So the idea here is that there is a domain of investigation that is totally worth exploring for epistemologists and that is left out by the assertion paradigm, namely those beliefs that are generated by non-assertory speech acts. I've made a claim about considering the investigation of this domain as an expansion of the existing research agenda of epistemology of testimony rather than an independent domain of inquiry. And I've shown you that a new interesting set of questions, set of research questions opens up once we expand onto this new domain of inquiry. So all questions will need new answers and altogether new questions open up for debate.